9 creepy mysteries involving unidentified people. Every year, there are numerous men and women found deceased whose identities are a complete mystery. They are simply known as John Doe or Jane Doe, until their real identities can be discovered. But unfortunately, sometimes this just never happens. Even though these people may have friends or family somewhere who are looking them, no one ever comes forward to claim the body. Years or decades go by without anyone finding out who they are. One of the most famous examples of this is the unidentified boy in the box found in Philadelphia in 1957. Here are some other examples of John or Jane Does being found under mysterious circumstances. Even though people have worked tirelessly to find out who they are, their identities remain unknown. 1. Who was Lyle Stevick? On September 17, 2001, a man was found dead in a small motel in a small town. A 911 call was made from the motel regarding a man who the caller believed to be dead, and two firefighters from the Amanda Park Fire Department responded to the call and were the first to arrive. They reached the same conclusion as the caller, and backed out of the motel room to await the arrival of the sheriff's deputies. After a lengthy investigation, spanning several states and involving law enforcement agencies on all levels, he was not able to be identified. Lyle checked into the motel in Amanda Park on Friday, September 14, 2001, at around 4 p.m. She describes his accent as Canadian, but she isn't sure. Nobody knows how he got to the hotel, although he showed up at the same time the buses from Forks and Aberdeen arrived. He may or may not have had a backpack. He didn't carry any identification, but the clerk let him in anyway, because he looked okay. About an hour after she gave him the key to room number 8, he complained about the noise from local trailer park and asked for another room. In this encounter, he is described as giving off bad vibes or being spaced by the clerk, and he made her nervous. She asks what he did in the first room and he says that he just messed up the pillows. She specifically asked him if he took a shower, and he says no, even though this wasn't true. The next day was mostly uneventful. Lyle was seen pacing up and down the highway. On the day after that, a Sunday, his body was found. He had tied his belt around his neck, with a buckle facing his chin and a small green washcloth between the belt and his skin, and tied the other end of the belt to a large metal pole in a small alcove in the motel room. He was not hanging off the ground. He was facing the wall with his head tilted back and his knees were touching the ground. He had hung pillows on either side of the small closet he was in, presumably to avoid making noise. He had left $160 and $20 bills wrapped in paper, with "for the room" written on the front. In the garbage can, police found a crumpled up note with "suicide" written on it, and Sunday's copy of the Daily World. There was also a copy of Sunday's The Daily World on the bed. Lyle didn't have any bags of clothes, and he had a small list of personal effects: a pen, a toothbrush, a tube of toothpaste, and $8 in dollar bills in his back pocket. The last person who is known to see him alive was the maid, who saw him Sunday morning. He turned away the maid's offer to clean the room, though he did ask for clean towels. The investigation into his identity started immediately. The address he gave in Meridian, Idaho was checked out by Meridian Police Department. It was found to be a Best Western Miramanda motel. Police in Meridian spoke to the manager of the motel and the manager did not recognize the description of Lyle as a recent guest or an employee. Police searched their database for Lyle Stevick but came up empty. Police in Amanda Park contacted police all over Washington, including the State Patrol, and nobody had any records of Lyle Stevick, his DNA, or his fingerprints. The search spanned many states, including California, Oregon, and Idaho. The FBI couldn't find him either, though they did add his prints to AFIS. His DNA was entered into CODIS by the Washington State Patrol. Almost 14 years later, "We still don't know who Lyle Stevick is. We don't know why he chose to die in Amanda Park, and we don't know what his connection, if any, is to Meridian." None of the questions have answers. 2. Caledonia Jane Doe. On January 26, the world learned the identity of the girl buried in a serene corner of a Dansville, NY, and cemetery. Her identity has not been known since her crumpled body was found in a cornfield in November 1979, her life snuffed out by a bullet to the forehead and another to the back. Yet, as York's regular presence at her headstone shows, she was remembered. She was remembered by York, and the dozens of men and women who worked for him, during the 24 years he was sheriff of Livingston County. and why. She was remembered by area residents who adorned her burial site with flowers. She was remembered by distant relatives whose recollections are now displayed online. She was remembered by a network of volunteer online detectives who match photos of the missing with unidentified people found dead. She was remembered by a childhood friend whose questions about the whereabouts of her pal ultimately helped lead to her identification. Until January 26, the girl buried at the Greenmount Cemetery was unidentified. But, for 35 years, Tammy Jo Alexander was not forgotten. On the morning of November 10, 1979, Wesley Clemens and his father, Harry, were in a pickup en route to a diner when Wesley, then only 16, spotted something unusual in the family cornfield. "That particular morning we were on our way down to grab a cup of coffee at the diner," Wesley said. "I said, 'Whoa, wait a minute. There's somebody lying in the cornfield, about 20 yards into the Caledonia, NY, field, scheduled to be combined that very day.' Lay a teenage girl, face down and dead." The father and son went to the nearby diner and telephoned police. The rest of the day was interrogations. Clemens said, "The girl appeared to be in her mid-teens. The wound to the head told a sad tale. She had apparently not turned or flinched, as is common when one is shot in the head. Instead, the entry wound suggested complete, if horrified, surprise. She wore a red windbreaker, tan corduroys and a plaid cotton shirt. Her hair appeared to have been recently dried from blonde to brown. Some of her teeth were severely decayed. She was tanned, the one sign that she was not local. Deputies and investigators combed the fields and surrounding area for miles, hoping the killer had discarded something. Hampered by hours of rain that preceded the discovery of Jane Doe, the search yielded nothing. Web sleuthing leads to idea of girl found dead in NY. Then a Sergeant York, who would be elected Livingston County's sheriff a decade later, remembers how the search for Jane Doe's name kept widening. It expanded from the Avon area, to the Rochester region, to the state of New York, to the nation. A handful of clues became dozens, which became hundreds, which became thousands, all leading to frustrating dead ends. York and his colleagues, joined by investigators with the state police and the FBI, did not relent. "I've always believed in homicide cases that victims have rights," said York, who retired as sheriff after 2013. John Walsh highlighted Jane Doe on his show, America's Most Wanted. Magazines and newspapers featured the girl's likeness. York interviewed serial killers in prison. As the years passed, the investigation into Jane Doe began to resemble a roadmap for the advancements in evidence gathering and forensics. Investigators kept snippets of her hair before she was buried, but those clippings did not include the roots, largely necessary for DNA testing. She was exhumed in 2005, as DNA testing entered the investigative toolkit, and genetic material was extracted from her bone and hair. A pollen sample from her clothing was tested, leading to a determination that she had been in Florida, Southern California, or the Southwest. The growth of the internet allowed authorities to send the likeness of Jane Doe, also called Callie because she was found in Caledonia, to millions of people, and a bevy of online sleuthing communities worked to figure out just who she was. One of those, websleuth.com, was central to the identification of Jane Doe, as a forum moderator realized that a recent missing person photograph of Tammy Jo Alexander, who disappeared from Florida in the late 1970s, bore a striking resemblance to Livingston County's Jane Doe. A childhood friend of Alexander's, questioning what had happened to her friend, provided the information used for the missing person posting. The friend, Arizona resident Laurel Noel, had seen a Facebook posting from another classmate who was asking about Tammy Jo. She connected with him, and then contacted Alexander's sister, Pamela Dryson. Upon learning that Alexander's family had not seen her since the 1970s, Noel discovered there was no missing person information online and took it upon herself to get the information circulated. Alexander's photograph and what was known about her disappearance was posted on the Justice Department's National Missing and Unidentified Persons System, or NAMIS, website. Last year when Web's loose moderator, Carl Koppelman, spotted the missing person record for 16-year-old Tammy Jo Alexander on NAMIS, he reached out to authorities and others to tell of the clear likeness. Investigators from Livingston County and the sheriff's office in Hernando County, Florida, where Alexander had lived, also saw the resemblance. They chased down surviving relatives, and a DNA comparison confirmed that Jane Doe was Tammy Jo Alexander, who turned 16 shortly before her death. "This is a wonderful day for us," Livingston County Sheriff's Chief Deputy Matthew Bridges, an investigator in the case, said Monday at the announcement of Jane Doe's identification. "It's the end of one chapter and the beginning of the next one, but this is just one battle. We've got the rest of the war to fight to find the person responsible for this. Now that investigators know who Jane Doe was, the next question is, who was Tammy Jo Alexander? This identification is huge for us," said Livingston County Sheriff Thomas Docherty, who was not born when Jane Doe was found dead. "I'm very proud of it. But this cold case is now burning hot and the next step is now bringing this killer to justice. Once you know the victim, you know 10 times more about the case. In the days since the identification was made public, the cyber world occasionally has engaged in a vitriol common to its universe, and the targets of the animus have been the now deceased parents of the teenager." Investigators in Florida and Livingston County say they have no record of a missing persons report, and no indication one was ever filed. That allegation prompted online commentators to question how parents could simply ignore a teenager who'd gone missing. Relatives say they were always told that the parents did report Tammy Jo missing. She was known to run away from home, and investigators are now looking into claims that she may have hitchhiked with truckers on trips as far from home as California. Alexander's sister, Dyson, who had a different father, moved away from the home when she was around 12 years old. After Alexander's disappearance, Dyson said, "There was always talk at family get-togethers and reunions about her possible whereabouts." She said she feels sure a missing person report was filed by the family. Sure a missing person. 3. Huntington Beach Jane Doe. A Jane Doe case that baffled investigators for 27 years, and was featured on Unsolved Mysteries, has finally been solved, thanks to cutting-edge FBI fingerprint analysis. Virginia woman Andrea Cooper, 26, was the person struck and killed by two cars in Huntington Beach, California on April 1, 1990. Officials with the Orange County Sheriff's Department revealed on Thursday, "We are thankful to know what happened to our daughter after all these years," Andrea's father, Richard Cooper, said in a statement. "Andrea was loved and respected. She was beautiful, but she was manic depressive, and therefore we had been through quite an adventure." The mystery that spanned decades began around 10 p.m. on April 1, 1990. On a scenic stretch of the Pacific Coast Highway that runs next to a public beach, a young woman trying to cross the road was struck by both a Mazda MX-6 and a Lincoln Continental, breaking her neck and killing her. The fatal crash in the dark of night was ruled accidental, and neither driver was charged with her death. The crash victim was wearing a black dress, pink sweater, fishnet stockings and pink heels. She had only two possessions on her body: a hotel room key and a ring on her left ring finger made of human hair. After local newspapers covered the case, two men came forward with information about the unidentified dead woman, whom they both knew only as Andrea. The first man said he and Andrea had both been hitchhiking along the Pacific Coast Highway 2 weeks prior to her death, and had shared a car along the way. Andrea told him that she was originally from Virginia, but then he later heard her tell a woman she was from New York. He said, she said she had been adopted and had traveled to California in search of her biological parents. The second man said Andrea had been penniless and hungry when he let her stay in a spare bedroom for one night and given her some food and money. This time, Andrea's story was that she had been adopted at a young age, but that her biological parents were a well-known celebrity couple, whom she didn't want to name. The second man revealed that the ring of human hair on Andrea's left hand was her own hair, which she had cut off and fashioned into the ring in front of him. The man gave Andrea some money and took her shopping for clothes at a Goodwill thrift store, where she spent $19.95 and purchased the pink shoes she was wearing when she was killed. Then the case went cold, and investigators were stumped as months turned to years, and years became decades. The investigators at the coroner's office never stopped trying to figure out who she was. Kelly Keyes, Orange County's supervising deputy coroner, said in a statement, "We never forgot her and would regularly pull out her file to see if we could think of anything new to try." Keyes said, investigators at the coroner's office tried running Andrea's information and fingerprints through new databases as they were created and expanded. As recently as 8 months ago, investigators revisited the case file after receiving information that Andrea may have had connections to Newport News, Virginia, but came up empty. Then, In early 2017, the National Missing and Unidentified Persons System, a U.S. Justice Department program, partnered with the FBI on a new fingerprint analysis project that more closely examines the fingerprints of unidentified bodies and compares them to an ever-expanding database of old prints from around the nation. On May 4, the FBI notified the coroner in California that they had found a match, 26-year-old Andrea Cooper of Fairfax, Virginia. Nearly three decades after their daughter went missing, Andrea's family finally has closure. 4. El Dorado Jane Doe. On July 10, 1991, a young blonde woman known to her friends as Mercedes was shot to death by her abusive ex-boyfriend, James McLaughlin, in a seedy motel room in El Dorado, Arkansas. Mercedes was carrying a Social Security card and identification card under the name Cheryl Ann Wick, but it turned out the real Cheryl Ann Wick was alive and well in Minneapolis and Mercedes had stolen her identity. No one seemed to know who Mercedes actually was. Even when James McLaughlin was caught and convicted of Mercedes' murder, he could not or would not provide her true identity. As a result, she became known as El Dorado Jane Doe. What's truly unique about El Dorado Jane Doe is that there are actual photographs of the victim which were circulated in the media and are currently available for viewing all over the internet, yet she has never been conclusively identified. It seems that anyone who recognized Jane Doe from the photos had only interacted with her in the years prior to her death, but no one knew where she actually came from. There were a lot of tantalizing clues. In addition to Mercedes and Cheryl Ann Wick, she had lived under such names as Sharon Wiley, Shannon Wiley, Cheryl Kaufman and Kelly Carr. She was known to have resided in Texas, Louisiana and Arkansas, worked as a topless dancer, and had been arrested for such crimes as prostitution and writing bad checks. The woman told many different stories to the different people she encountered over the years. She told some people she had two kids who were being taken care of by her estranged mother, but also shared another story with someone about having a kid taken away from her by social services while she was in a Dallas homeless shelter. Other wild tales included that she was wanted for a bank robbery in Virginia, and that she was living in a witness protection program because her father was in the mafia. No one knows for sure if any of these stories are true. A few months ago, the Huffington Post recently ran an article about El Dorado Jane Doe which featured an interview with James McLaughlin. McLaughlin received a 15-year sentence for Mercedes' murder, but went back to prison in 2011 for another crime. McLaughlin now says he knows Mercedes' full backstory, but will not reveal it unless he is paid $4,000. The most interesting piece of information he provided was that Mercedes was connected to the Fort Worth 3, the case where three young girls vanished during a shopping trip to a Fort Worth mall on December 23, 1974. According to McLaughlin, Mercedes and the three girls were raised in captivity as part of a prostitution ring and became close friends. However, investigators say that McLaughlin is a pathological liar and that no one should believe anything he says. It's also worth mentioning that Mercedes was considered a person of interest in the 1988 Oklahoma murder of a truck driver named Wayne Kirkendale, a case which was featured on Unsolved Mysteries. The day before the Kirkendale murder, a young blonde woman resembling Mercedes had tried to force herself into another truck driver's rig, which was parked only 13 miles away from the rest stop where Kirkendale was murdered. At one point, Mercedes had told people that a male companion had used her to lure truckers out of their rigs so they could rob them, but her companion wound up murdering a trucker. It's possible she was referring to Dwayne Kirkendale. In spite of all these leads, no one has ever been able to uncover her true identity. 5. Little Miss Panisovsky. It's the stuff of popular mystery fiction. A young woman from a European village disappears in Florida in the wake of Epiphany, the Greek Orthodox celebration that annually attracts thousands to the coastal community of Tarpon Springs. The story might be true. It might not. But Sumter County Sheriff's Office Detective Darren Norris thinks he knows how it ends, with a rotting body floating in a lake fringed by pine woods in central Florida. In fact, the end of the story is the only part that's certain. On February 19, 1971, hitchhikers discovered a woman's corpse beneath the Interstate 75 bridge over the marshy southern rim of Lake Panisovkee north of Bushnell. She was carrying no ID, with what remained of the body. A medical examiner determined she was strangled, and had probably been dumped in the lake at least 30 days before she was found. She was buried at the Oak Grove Cemetery in Wildwood, then exhumed in 1986 for re-examination. A 1993 episode of Unsolved Mysteries highlighted the case of the Jane Doe who had become known as Little Miss Lake Panasoffkee. Decades passed, no leads emerged. It became one of those cold cases kicked around at every police agency, passed from one generation of homicide investigators to the next. Then, earlier this year, Norris came across an article on forensics innovations spearheaded by an anthropology professor at the University of South Florida. Little Miss Lake Panasoffkee was getting ready to emerge again into the public eye, and this time, investigators believed she could be traced to the Tampa Bay area. Whether the rest of her story would emerge this time was anyone's guess. Erin Kimmerle is a Tampa forensic anthropologist with a reputation for helping to crack seemingly insoluble cold cases. Her USF Labs cold case project has pioneered methods for attaching names to unidentified bodies discovered in the state of Florida. When Norris read about her work, he thought she could lend a hand with his 41-year-old cold case. He was right. Working from photographs and detailed police records of the corpse and rags of clothing found in Lake Panasoffkee in 1971, Kimmerle's lab developed the most complete picture yet of the victim. She was young, between 17 and 24 years old, the lab hypothesized, and petite, less than 5 feet 5 inches tall and about 115 pounds. She had dark hair and brown eyes, prominent cheekbones and a strong nose. At the time she was killed, she was wearing green plaid pants, a matching green shirt and a green floral poncho. The woman's skeletal structure suggested she was of European descent, Kimmerle said. High-density strands in her bones, called Harris lines, indicated she had endured some kind of childhood ailment that briefly arrested her growth, perhaps malnutrition or sickness. It was all new information to the Sumter County Sheriff's Office. It's not uncommon at all that when we reanalyze cold cases, we get new information, Kimmerle said. More was to come. Little Miss Lake Panasoffkee's remains were sent to George Kamenov in the Department of Geological Sciences at the University of Florida. Kamenov tried to determine where she was from by studying the lead isotopes in her teeth. His method is based on the way elements from the environment leave their traces in the human body. Lead accumulates in children's teeth as they mature, until the tooth enamel seals off what can be viewed as a kind of snapshot of the place they lived. The method is particularly useful in guessing whether somebody was born in Europe or the United States, Kamenov said. The teeth of those who grew up in Europe carry a distinctive lead signal, since European countries used leaded gasoline from Australia at a time when North American countries did not. Kamenov went further, comparing Little Miss Lake Panasoffkee's lead levels to those on record in various parts of Europe. He was able to pinpoint her possible hometown, Lavrion, a small fishing port southeast of Athens, Greece. Detectives had never worked from so detailed a picture of Little Miss Lake Panasoffkee. It got them thinking. Not too far down I-75 was a large Greek community that sprawled from Clearwater through Tarpon Springs up to Newport Richey. The drive from those towns to the area where the body was dumped would have taken almost 2 hours. But maybe it wasn't too far for whoever had strangled Little Miss Lake Panasoffkee, a person who might not have wanted to deposit a victim too close to home. Her estimated time of death would have fallen in the weeks after Epiphany. Could she have traveled from Greece to Florida to celebrate? I was excited. Everyone here was excited, Norris said. It gave us a much better place to target. Now we have the information that might actually lead us to identify this person, and maybe even solve the case. On Friday, Norris mailed almost 6,000 pamphlets to residents and businesses in Tarpon Springs. He's hoping that someone might recognize the composite sketch of the dead woman that stares out impassively from the flyer with brown, almond-shaped eyes. He has approached the Tarpon Springs Police Department and community leaders in the hope of new leads. It could be that whoever killed Little Miss Lake Panasoffkee is still alive and in the area, he believes. Anything's possible, he said. It's also entirely possible that the quest for a Gulf Coast connection will be futile. The biographical and geographical profile of Little Miss Lake Panasoffkee pieced together by scientists deals in probabilities, not certainties. It could be she was of Latino or Native American descent, though the likelihood of European descent is stronger. Even a measure as precise as the lead isotopes in her teeth is open to divergent interpretations. Let's say her house was painted with leaded paint from Europe. She would gather up the same signal in her teeth, Kamenov said. That's why we cannot be 100% sure. Even if she was from Greece, We don't have anything that could pinpoint that this victim was from here, said Tarpon Springs Police Captain Jeffrey Young. He said police have scoured their records for reports of missing persons or crimes in the 1970s that might be connected to the unidentified woman, and have turned up nothing. Father Michael Icrino, Dean of St. Nicholas Greek Orthodox Cathedral in Tarpon Springs, said that while tens of thousands attend the town's renowned Epiphany celebration on January 6, most visitors are from the United States, not Greece, which has its own prominent celebrations. Asked whether he thought it likely someone would travel from Greece to Tarpon Springs for Epiphany, Icrino said, I really can't picture it, but stranger things have happened. Stranger things have happened. A 41-year-old corpse was revived through modern forensics into a portrait of a living woman, down to the plaid pants she was wearing when she was strangled. A close look at her teeth pointed to a village on the Mediterranean Sea as the place where she grew up. Norris is optimistic that someone, somewhere in the Greek communities of Pinellas or Pasco, will know something about her, about what happened. As he says, anything's possible. 6. Unidentified Grateful Dead fan. Police call him Grateful Doe, but all they really know, 18 years after he was found dead at the side of the road, is locked in a secret surrounding a handful of stray clues, four quarters, two Grateful Dead ticket stubs, a Bic lighter and a cryptic note mentioning two people named Carolyn. That's what police found at the crash scene on the afternoon of Monday, June 26, 1995, when authorities arrived to investigate a fatal car accident in Emporia, Greensville County, Virginia. The vehicle went off the side of the road, braked and crashed head on into two trees, Lieutenant Ted Jones of the Virginia State Police told the Huffington Post. The occupants were not restrained and were both partially ejected through the windshield. Both occupants, Jones said, died of massive head injuries at the scene, presumably upon impact. There was no presence of drugs in either of their systems. Jones said, it's my opinion that the driver fell asleep at the wheel. That is based upon the lengthy and gradual departure of the vehicle from the paved surface. Jones added, they were in a Volkswagen Van Agen. It's a cab over design with a rear engine mount, so they had no protection up front from anything. Police were able to identify the driver as Michael Hager, a 21-year-old student at the University of South Carolina. Contacted by HuffPost on Wednesday, Hager's father and stepmother declined to comment on the circumstances leading up to the accident. According to Jones, Hager had been visiting his girlfriend in Fairfax County, Virginia, and had left her home at about 7:45 a.m. on the day of the crash. Later that day, Hager stopped at his father's home in Gloucester County. His father wasn't there at the time, but Hager did call him at about 12 p.m. to say he was on his way to his mother's house in Inman, South Carolina. Hager did not mention having anyone with him, police said. In July 1996, article in the Freelance Star, a Virginia newspaper, a neighbor of Hager's father had reported seeing a young man with Hager when he stopped at his father's house. Jones said the report is incorrect. When he stopped at his father's house, he was alone. Jones said, the theory is that the passenger was a hitchhiker. Hager, likely picked up between Gloucester and Emporia. Whatever the case may be, the accident occurred roughly 90 minutes after Hager called his father. The passenger had no identification, and none of Hager's friends or family members knew the man or had any information about Hager traveling with another person. The unidentified man's fingerprints were not in any law enforcement database, and he did not match any missing person reports. Further hindering investigators was the fact that the injuries to the passenger's face were so severe that authorities were unable to release a photo of him to the public. The only thing the coroner could determine was that the young man was between 15 and 21 years of age. In the passenger's pockets, police found the four quarters, a Bic lighter and the two ticket stubs. The stubs were from a Grateful Dead concert at Robert F. Kennedy Stadium in Washington, D.C. on June 24 and 25, 1995. The two-day event had drawn fans from across the U.S., with an estimated 60,000 concertgoers in attendance. The concert made headlines around the world after its opening day, when three people were struck by lightning while waiting outside the stadium. All three survived, although one was left permanently disabled. The concert was also of note to fans, as it was one of lead singer Jerry Garcia's last performances. He died of a heart attack less than 2 months later. According to Jones, the ticket stubs, along with the appearance of the unidentified young man, which included a Grateful Dead tie-dye t-shirt from the 1995 summer tour, led investigators to believe the young man was a Deadhead, a name given to fans of the Grateful Dead. Jones managed to trace the sale of the tickets back to the original buyer, but discovered they were part of a bulk purchase the man had made. The tickets had been scalped to strangers outside the concert, with Grateful Dead presumably buying it then. Authorities found no evidence suggesting Hager had attended the Grateful Dead concert, which Jones said adds to his belief that Grateful Dead was a hitchhiker. However, Jones does believe the Grateful Dead was a mutual interest that prompted Hager to give the young man a ride. Based on the personal items Hager had in the age of the two, they appeared to be into the same trends and styles. Jones said, both were fans and both had affinities to the Grateful Dead following lifestyle. In addition to the items found on Grateful Dead, authorities found a note near the site of the crash that was addressed to someone named Jason. To Jason, sorry we had to go. See you around. Carolyn O. and Carolyn T. The note read. It also had a small doodle and a phone number with a 914 prefix. Jones said authorities do not know if the note belonged to Hager, Grateful Dead, or someone with no connection to either. At the time of the accident, some media outlets mistakenly reported that the note was found in Grateful Dead's pocket. Jones said that information is incorrect. It was found within proximity of the vehicle and may not have even been in his original possession. Jones said reports suggesting the doodle on the note was a caricature of Jerry Garcia are also incorrect. It is a random doodle, he said. We had looked into Grateful Dead connection and never saw any link between that illustration and the Grateful Dead or their followers. The phone number proved to be a dead end. There was no area code, and when investigators called variations of the number, they were unable to find anyone with any connection to the note. Jones said, the forensics lab was also unable to lift any fingerprints from it. Authorities also have no idea where Grateful Dead was heading at the time of the accident. He was evidently not following the Grateful Dead to their next venue, as the next show was in Michigan and Hager was headed in the opposite direction. Obviously, because of the time that's passed and no solid leads, I can only assume maybe he was from foster care early on and maybe floated from family to family. Jones said, I say that based on that kind of lifestyle, following the Grateful Dead from venue to venue, he may have found his own family in that cult-like following. Jones no longer works on the Grateful Dead case. I investigated everything from every angle, and nothing ever panned out, he said. Jones said the case is now in the hands of the state medical examiner's office in Richmond, Virginia, where it is managed by Dr. Kevin Whaley. HuffPost made numerous calls to Whaley this week, but none were returned. Today, nearly 20 years after his death, the story of Grateful Dead, or Jason Dead as he is sometimes called, would likely be all but forgotten were it not for members of Web Sleuth, an online community of volunteers who brainstorm unsolved mysteries. For the past several years, multiple Web Sleuth members, including two known as Killarney Rose and Rainwater, have picked apart the case and helped raise awareness about it on social media. He was someone's son, brother, grandson, nephew, uncle, and it is so hard to believe that in this day and time that no one can identify him. Killarney Rose told HuffPost, explaining why she is dedicated to the case. Although Grateful Dead fans may not know each other's names, at a Dead concert all are members of the same family for magical hours, Rainwater said. We want to see this family member given back his name. Grateful Dead is described as a white male, between 15 and 21 years old, 5 feet, 8 inches tall and approximately 169 pounds. He had curly light brown to dark blonde shoulder-length hair and brown eyes. His left earlobe was pierced, but he had no earring at the time of his death. He was wearing light blue jeans, a Grateful Dead tie-dye t-shirt from the 1995 summer tour, size 11 and a half Isla sneakers, and a macrame bead necklace. He had a homemade tattoo of a star on his upper left arm in a faint pattern, possibly a faded homemade tattoo of an unknown design, on his upper right arm. He also had a scar on the middle of his back. 7. Baby Hope. Detectives solve the decades-old mystery of Baby Hope, a little girl whose body was discovered inside a picnic cooler beside the Manhattan Highway in 1991, and arrested a relative of the child Saturday after he admitted he sexually assaulted and smothered her, police said. Conrado Juarez, 52, was arrested on a murder charge and was awaiting arraignment. Police Commissioner Raymond Kelly said Juarez claimed he killed the girl at his sister's apartment and that she helped him dispose of the body. The sister has since died, police said. They were cousins of the little girl's father. The girl's name, age and circumstances of her death were unknown for more than two decades. But earlier this week, police announced that a new tip and a DNA test had allowed them to finally identify the baby's mother, a dramatic turnaround in one of the city's more notorious cold cases. On Saturday, they also revealed the girl's name, Angelica Castillo, age 4. The child's naked, malnourished corpse was discovered on July 23, 1991, beside the Henry Hudson Parkway by construction workers who smelled something rotten. Detectives thought she might have been suffocated but had few other clues as to what happened. The case became an obsession for some investigators who nicknamed the girl Baby Hope. Hundreds of people attended a funeral for the unknown girl in 1993. Her body was exhumed for DNA testing in 2007, and then again in 2011. In July, detectives tried another round of publicity on the 22nd anniversary of the discovery. They canvassed the neighborhood where her body was found, hung flyers, circulated sketches of the girl and a photograph of the cooler and announced a $12,000 reward for information leading to an arrest. Former Detective Jerry Giorgio, who had the case from 1991 until his retirement over the summer, said he remained confident the case could be solved. Assistant Chief Joseph Resnick, who also worked the case, said they never gave up. "I think reflecting back on what we named this little girl, Baby Hope, I think it's the most accurate name we could have come up with," Resnick said. Giorgio left the night and went to the Manhattan District Attorney's Cold Case Squad, from which he retired this year. "I missed the tipster call by a couple of weeks, damn it," he said. The tipster, who saw the recent news stories on the case, led police to Angelica's sister, who told detectives she thought her sister had been killed. Police matched DNA from Angelica to their mother. The mother, who was not identified, didn't have custody of Angelica at the time of the girl's death. She had been living with relatives on the father's side, including Balvina Juarez Ramirez, police said. Juarez Ramirez is the sister of Juarez. Police closed in on the suspect and waited for him Friday outside a Manhattan restaurant where he worked as a dishwasher. He told them he noticed Angelica while visiting the family apartment and killed her, police said. When she went motionless, he summoned his sister from another room, Kelly said. Then, the sister got the blue cooler, which still contained full cans of Coke. They took a livery cab from Queens to Manhattan where they dumped the cooler, then separated. Her parents never reported her missing, though they had contact with the suspect. Juarez had never been considered a suspect before. Police refused to say whether he had previous arrests or had been accused in other sexual assaults. Kelly called the arrest a superb case of detective work, and said he was proud of his officers. "For me, it makes you proud to be a member of this organization. They were unrelenting," he said. The detectives assigned to the case were instrumental in organizing a burial in the Bronx cemetery for the girl in 1993. Hundreds attended the funeral. Resnick gave the eulogy. The girl was dressed in a white frock and buried in a white coffin. The detectives paid for the girl's headstone that reads, "Because we care." On the tomb sit two little angels. 8. Sumter County Mystery Couple. In 1976, this female and her companion were found dead on a secluded Sumter County, South Carolina dirt road between Interstate 95 and SC 341. They were located by a truck driver who pulled off to rest at what was commonly known as Locklear Road, a frontage road just off the interstate. Neither had any identification. They had both been shot in the throat, chest and back. On August 9, 1976, a man living in the sticks between Sumter and Florence heard a car scuttling down a narrow frontage road connecting Interstate 95 to SC 341. Someone climbed out, gunshots echoed in the early morning, then the car raced back onto the highway. They had no money on them, but there were several clues that led investigators to believe that the couple might have been well-to-do or perhaps even from another country. Investigators wondered if they had been hitchhiking cross-country, or if they had been victims of a carjacking. They were a clean-cut looking pair. Authorities speculated they might even be brother and sister. DNA testing, however, later proved that they were not related. No drugs or alcohol were found on their bodies. They were not smokers, and neither had on underwear. Investigators had checked out every lead, including trying to identify them through their fingerprints, and using the serial number on the man's watch in hopes of trying to track down the jewelry store where he might have bought the piece of jewelry. Officials with Interpol as well as U.S. Customs investigators and immigration authorities also had been alerted. Contact were made with agencies in Argentina, Uruguay, Brazil, and in the Mediterranean. The autopsy revealed the pair had eaten fruit or ice cream with fruit not long before they died, so investigators were certain the two must have bought the food from a local eatery or store. Someone remembered seeing a couple matching the dead couple's descriptions at a fruit stand that was located off the Florence Highway, but the person couldn't say whether the man and woman were with someone else or if they were riding in a car. Months after the homicide, an employee of Coe Campgrounds near Santee, SC, called authorities, believing he had earlier made friends with a dead man, who went by the name Jock, according to documents in the case file. Jock, or more likely, Jacques, stayed a few days at the campgrounds with his young female companion, then left for Florida. He and his girlfriend stopped at the campgrounds again on their way back. The two men became friends. While shooting pool, Jacques told the co-worker he was the son of a prominent doctor in Canada who had disowned him for giving up on his own career in medicine. He was taking a vacation of sorts, traveling the country aimlessly. Before leaving, he tried to pawn an expensive ring to the employee, who later told authorities that the ring had looked a lot like the one found on the mystery man. Inside his pocket was a book of Grand Struck Stop matches, which could only be found in Idaho, New Mexico and Nebraska. Authorities think Jacques passed through these places on his travels. There are speculations that this female is an exchange student from the Middle East. 9. Beth Doe. On December 20, 1976, a teenager walking along the banks of the Lehigh River outside this Pocono Mountains town made a gruesome discovery: the dismembered remains of a young woman and her full-term fetus. 30 years later, police are no closer to finding her killer, primarily because they were still missing a crucial bit of information. Try as they might, authorities haven't come close to making an identification, and their prospects dim a little more with each passing year. "It's as cold can be, unfortunately," said Corporal Thomas McAndrew, a state police detective who took over the case a year ago. "The killer's never been caught, and never will be until we find out who she is." The woman was strangled, shot, dismembered and stuffed into three suitcases that were flung over a bridge along Interstate 80. The killer was probably aiming for the Lehigh River, 300 feet below, but missed. Two of the suitcases broke open on impact, spilling the victim's head and torso and her female fetus. The third suitcase contained the woman's arms and legs. Her nose and ears had been cut off. The coroner estimated she had been dead less than 24 hours. The crime scene yielded a wealth of evidence, but little of it was useful. In addition to her remains, investigators had the suitcases, all of them the same size and missing their handles. Some body parts were wrapped in a rust-colored chenille bedspread. Six soggy sections of the New York Sunday News covered her torso. A series of letters and numbers, written in ink on the palm of her left hand, provided a tantalizing clue. But a police check of license plates and CB call signs turned up nothing. "She haunts me, she really does," said Nancy Monahan, the Pennsylvania director of the Doe Network, a group of amateur sleuths that seeks to attach names to unidentified bodies. "I've had dreams about her, dreams, and questions, such as, how could a young woman, about to give birth, have simply vanished days or weeks before Christmas and no one reported her missing? Was she someone on the margins of society, an illegal immigrant, perhaps? Was her own family covering up for the killer, and that's why no one came forward? And what about that writing on her hand?" At the Whitehaven Police Department, where an artist's conception of what a victim looked like hangs on a wall, Patrolman Thomas Shoke has his own theories about the case. "My feeling is she has probably run away from another state and her family doesn't know what happened to her," he said. "Or she may have been a throwaway, where the parent says, 'You're 15, get out.'" The victim's family might have even filed a missing persons report, Shoke said, but such a report, if it exists, would likely be collecting dust in a police department file cabinet somewhere. McAndrew said he would like to exhume the body to gather DNA samples, but the process is time-consuming and expensive. And while DNA samples can be run through FBI and missing persons databases, a match would be a long shot, given the time elapsed. DNA testing can be used in unidentified body cases, but it is not an important tool at this time because the number of people whose DNA is on record anywhere represents a very very small percentage of the population, state police spokesman Jack Lewis said via email. The victim had previous dental work, and her fetus was healthy at the time of death, indicating the woman took care of herself and her unborn daughter. For McAndrew, learning her identity would be a small way to give her some dignity. It's amazing that no one has identified her, that somebody out there isn't missing her, he said. The victim and her fetus are buried in a pauper's cemetery several miles from where the remains were found. The tomb is marked with a simple white cross and a small granite marker that says, Beth Doe, which, unless there is a miraculous break in the case, is how history will remember her.